We are leaving the mooring field now. We're going around the corner to Salt Run. Mike's been in there before, so I'm gonna let him take the lead or point or whatever you call it. Let's see if we can see it on the map here. Yeah, just before the inlet, you cut a right, and there it is. Obviously, I'm having issues here, but it's around this Salt Run, right over by Conch Island. Shallow, high tide, but again, Mike has breadcrumbs, so hopefully we're all good, and hopefully it's not too busy in there. It seems like when you're underway, there's a lot of things that you're hopeful for. Hope we get there soon so I can pee. I'm starting to do the pee-pee dance. Since Mike had been in here before and told me that the channel leading up to the anchorage was deep, I figured I'd at least give it a look-see. But I was still suspicious about the place that he had planned for us to anchor our boats.
I'm going to show you a couple of spots. Somewhere in the mess up ahead, I'm assuming.
I had checked the reviews on Navionics of this anchorage before, and they were less than favorable. They talked of soft mud and poor holding.
I gotta be mindful that we can swing different sailboat than us.
Right,
and
that's what I'm there. So I was right here the first time. Gives you plenty of off distance swing. We're in a solid 10 feet of water.
Another reason I didn't want to stay here is that there was a boat ramp right there, and there was a red and green channel marking where everybody would be coming and going. Anchoring in here is not something that I thought was a good idea. This is a beautiful spot. Look at that. Beautiful. But too tight. I'm not going to drift across somebody's anchor line or into somebody's boat or. Nope, nope, nope. Nope.
No, 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 no.
Well, yeah. I had put my foot down, and yet again, for the benefit of my boat, I had to find someplace else to go. It really hurt to leave my buddy, but as I was leaving the anchorage, I looked over here and I saw these mooring balls. Some of them were broken, some of them were empty, and I thought, man, that would be such a better place to anchor up. So I decided to check my phone. I knew that those moorings were owned by the municipal marina. I found their number on the Navionics app, called them up, and sure enough, some of them were still operational and available.
All right, I'm back and trying to find a mooring ball over here. 29 is back there somewhere. Let's see what I can find.
Just after I had finished giving the marina my credit card information, I lost a signal and the phone call got dropped. So I didn't have an accurate description as to where this mooring ball number 29 was.
This particular case, I'm glad I've got high tide with me. 37, Jesus. I'm hoping this is it. Show me a number. Yeah, 37. Of course, there ain't no damn number on this. Why is there no number?
After a lot of frustration, I realized, you know what, I'm just going to take this ball, and if somebody has a problem with it, or it's the wrong one, they can come say something to me. But at this point, I just wanted to stop and be secure. I grabbed the mooring ball and had it tied off on the very first shot. I was starting to get pretty good at this, I thought. But more than that, I had a secure place for myself and the boat for the next couple of days.
Yeah, 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 yeah. I got no spit. Alright, good. This is so much nicer. And now my depth finder is working. Really? Really?
I just saw too many things that could possibly go wrong, especially with how often I had been dragging anchor, to stay in that spot, especially considering how cheap the moorings were.
$16 a night he's gonna save by anchoring up over there. My goodness.
But to each his own, and to his credit, nothing has happened to Mike or his boat yet. And I found myself a nice secure spot where I could eventually decompress after a nice meal. But as they say, may you live in interesting times. And somebody with an interesting boat decided to come check my interesting boat out. I just told this guy that I thought I had the coolest boat in the anchorage, but he might have me beat. Yes, sir. Are you okay?
Yeah. All right. Yeah. I'll go back out a little bit.
Wilson's Rescue. You gotta have a look at this.
This won't get hurt if you're worried about, are you worried about?
Yeah, well, I don't want your boat to get damaged.
No, it's not gonna get damaged.
Okay.
No, it's good.
All right.
Yeah, definitely not.
You're standing on the beach and this is the dock.
Yeah.
I love the use of PVC. That's right, this is PVC. And that is PVC.
This is PVC board.
Unbelievable. You're a man of many talents. And styrofoam.
Yep.
And, wow.
Just standing on the beach.
Yeah, permission to come aboard.
Yeah.
This thing is extremely buoyant, it seems. It is nice and soft.
Well, so this is EPS, which you know.
A expanded polystyrene.
Right. So 1 cubic foot of EPS will float 60 pounds at water level. So this started out as a 5 foot by 10 foot by 2 foot block. Okay, even carving away what I did for the beach.
Yep.
You could probably put 5,000 pounds on here before it would be at water level. I've had 8 adults on here, and it was drafting about 8 inches of water.
Oh my gosh. So awesome.
Yep.
Yeah, you definitely think outside the box, man, and hit it out of the park, I think.
Well, I appreciate that.
What's your name again?
Bill.
Bill.
Yep.
Awesome.
Yeah,
cool. On camera now. You had, yeah. How did you do this?
What's that?
The little rings on the
okay, well,
PVC.
So you take, first of all, before you get to that ring part, you take your PVC and you sand it vertically to get the grains.
So then you can faux finish it.
Right. Then, once you've sanded it vertically, then you take that piece of PVC and you roll it around you know, with the blowtorch or whatever, blowtorch, and you spin it around and around and around and around and around until it's soft enough, and you just compress it.
Yep.
And then cool it quick with a wet sponge, and and then sand it one more time, because that takes that high edge to white and also just blends it a little bit.
Yeah.
And then stain.
I've tried to do this unsuccessfully.
That's actually a Wilson.
Wilson?
Yeah. Mm. Oh my God, I love this, man. I love it, I love it, I love it.
And the name, of course, is, you get the picture on the ring. Yep. Wilson's Rescue.
Wilson's Rescue.
So I figure the next one I'm building, which is right around the corner here, I'm getting ready to do it because I just got back in off the road, and is going to be a whole lot bigger, but it's going to be 6 feet by 12 feet, and it's going to have a full tiki.
Yeah.
That you could sit 4 people under. And we'll have a proper, you know, captain's pilot station.
Sure.
And then a bigger beach and
a bigger
dock. And that's about it. Yeah. And let's see here. You know, like, you'll be able to, and I can still do it on this one, I'm thinking about it. Take these three here and put your cooler under there. So you lift up the dock and there's your cooler, your beer cooler.
I love that you got FL numbers on it and everything.
Oh, yeah. Had to register it. It's motorized.
Yes, anything with a motor, you got to register.
Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, you could go, I mean, I could see this going with and go with a jet drive. Okay. Or better yet, how about, you know, the 36 volt,
like an electric
motors, sure. The thruster motor. Okay. And they actually have phone apps to control them.
So it could be remote control.
You could take your smartphone and drive your island around.
You think outside the box, my friend. More people need to do that.
Oh, there's a few wandering around.
Yeah, one or two.
Yeah.
So we got red.
It'll obviously light.
Sure.
Light up later, it gets. Later.
Stern light, of course. That is pretty neat. Do you want to go for a ride? Can you do it without going swimming? These are the U.S. Coast Guard cookie inspectors looking for illegal rawhides or milk bones, anything like that on board. No.
Contraband. Don't weigh cats.
Yes. Yeah. No. No cats on board. No. Jabs. Don't you go swimming.
Good boys.
Hanging out on the beach. Yeah.
The beach.
Okay. Give a little push.
Yeah.
Little choke.
There. Gotta choke it.
Yeah.
Maybe not.
Note to self, always start the motor before you untie the lines.
Now this is highly unusual.
Is it?
Yeah.
Uh-oh. You got any fuel?
Uh-oh. This is crazy.
Huh. You got the little kill switch thing in?
Yeah, let me double check that. Wow.
Okay, I can edit this out, you know.
This is never ever.
Hmm.
Seriously, this is like.
Uh oh. You got a paddle.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, there we go.
Yeah, I had to choke it. We're sitting a little longer than.
Yes, we were.
What are you doing?
That's pretty. So, yep. New friends. On an island.
Yep.
Pretty neat, huh? Sitting in the mooring field. Cruising around. What do you think, pups?
Pretty cool, huh?
My thanks to Bill for taking me out on his very creative little craft, which wound up being a really nice end to a somewhat stressful day. And although I did not choose to anchor where Mike had suggested, I am glad he talked me into coming back into the salt run here, because it truly is a magnificent place. Because you get to park really close to the lighthouse. It's hard to describe how amazing it is, even with this video. How brightly the light shone, and how tight the beam was. Overall, St. Augustine was a very, very cool place. But we weren't too far away from moving on and heading north. Little by little, we were getting closer and closer to finishing up our time here in Florida.